WVUA-FM, Tuscaloosa.
Welcome to WVUA 90.7 FM, the Capstone. We are back with another week of Student Section MLB with a big week ahead of us. I'm Will Miller, joined by
Luke Torre
and Carson Keel.
And we are all depressed fans because our teams did not make it to the World Series. It's a very sad time all around, but you know what? We play on. We have the most important series of baseball coming up on Friday, and it's Wednesday, so we're really 2 days away.
Let's go Phillies.
From the World Series.
Let's go Astros.
Whoa.
You're fired.
Yeah. Get out. Leave.
But as you've heard, the World Series is between the Philadelphia Phillies wild card team out of the National League East and the Houston Astros, the number one seed in the American League. So quite a disparity there. We're going to get into a World Series preview later on tonight, but we do have some big news to start things out with. The manager carousel is off and running, and the Miami Marlins have come to a decision on who it's going to be. They've hired former Cardinals bench coach and longtime Padres coach Skip Schumacher to be their manager. Skip played with the Cardinals for a lot of years, and he's spent the last few years in coaching. Ollie Marmol had a rough end of the season, and to me that doesn't inspire a lot of confidence in his disciple, especially to basically rebuild the Marlins again after they let Don Mattingly go. What are you guys' thoughts on the hire?
So letting go of Mattingly, I thought it was a really interesting kind of thing, because I thought he was kind of like the man. Because
I mean, yeah, like he led them to the playoffs.
Well, of course, that was the 2020 playoffs. Like
they won a series though in those playoffs.
That is true. That is true. But those were very interesting playoffs to say the least. But he seemed like, even with some super bad teams, it seemed that there was confidence in him, where he could take this team farther and farther. And yet here we are. And he's let go. Well, not fired, but just not renewed on his contract. Same thing. But interesting choice. I feel like it's a little too risky, if you ask me. I joked with someone as soon as I saw the news. The Marlins have found themselves another 5 years of failure. And that's all I can think about. Like this, I don't think this was a good hire. I think this was a little too jerky of a hire, where you drill too quick. They should have stuck with Don, or they should have gone for someone with more experience. I feel like this is a Marlins team that does not need a rookie at the bench right now.
Yeah, I didn't love the hire. I thought there were a lot of better options on the market than him. I like your point with getting experience. You got a young team there, extremely young but talented team with a great pitching staff. And I just don't think you add young to young. I think you got to add a guy with experience to a young roster like that so they know what to do. Listen, I wouldn't be baffled if they stayed exactly the same, but or even got better, but I'm not expecting them to do much.
I think they're going to go under 500 again. I don't think they're.
Well, I don't know that anybody doubts that. I will say this for the record. I mean, the Cardinals obviously one of the most successful organizations in baseball, although their playoff performance indicated anything but earlier this month. Nevertheless, I agree with Carson's term. I do think this was a knee-jerk hire. And look, if you got your number one guy, you got your number one guy. And I think there's something to be said for that at the organizational level, that you had a guy at the top of your board, you're able to get him. But the question then becomes, should he have been in that position? Now, I thought the hire was Matt Quartaro, the Rays bench coach.
Yeah.
And he is sure to be the candidate, I think, for all openings this season. I think he'll get a job. It just remains to be seen where. I thought for sure it was going to be Miami. I would have thought Miami had him at the top. I would have, if I given where Miami is and what the Rays have been able to do without a lot of resources.
With young players, very young players. So, yeah, I think
so. It seemed like
that would have been a better fit.
To accomplish what they want to accomplish, because we've been talking about how young of a team they are. I would have thought that he – and look, maybe he goes to be a manager and he sucks. I don't think that'll happen, but say he did. Well, I don't really think that he would have been a worse bet than Skip. With that being said, I don't hope Skip fails.
Agree.
This is not really. I don't like the Marlins, and I hope Skip doesn't hit Acuna like Mattingly used to. I'm not saying this is an indictment of him as a coach or whatever it may be, but I just believe that this may have been too quick in the process. I mean, the World Series isn't even over yet. We are still in season for Major League Baseball.
Right, but I'm sure we're going to talk about this in a little bit. But I feel like this hire was a little bit maybe induced by the Rangers with their choice, which we'll talk about in a bit.
We'll talk about that right after we're done with this.
Yeah, but the issue is it's like you're putting a square piece through a round hole. This feels like it doesn't feel right. It just feels like it doesn't fit. I think it'll probably last 2 years and that's it. Again, I hate to say that, but again, I this felt like a really bad knee-jerk induced choice.
Yeah, and we're going to bring up the Rangers manager choice because it was a big one. Bruce Shocked. Bochy was rumored to be coming back to managing. Throughout the past years, the Padres' job obviously came open last year when Jay Stengel was fired. People attached him to that. He led him to the World Series eons ago. And he's now back with the Texas Rangers, which I expected him to go to the White Sox. But clearly the White Sox aren't going to go upper on the age spectrum after the Tony La Russa situation.
Yeah.
But still, I thought they would take a chance on a guy with three World Series in basically the past decade. Nevertheless, it's the Texas Rangers who have hired Bruce Bochy. They've drawn him out of retirement. Previously, his last management position was with the Giants. He retired from there after the 2019 season, so all told, he will have spent three seasons out of managing. I think this is a great choice for Texas. I really do. I mean, Chris Woodward just didn't have the tools all around. He was a good coach, but he just didn't have the tools all around to develop a roster, to make lineups that could consistently deliver, things like that, that when you get down to it are just intangibles for baseball. So I think that he'll return to a role that better suits him in the future, maybe not as a manager. But I think this vastly extends the trajectory for the Rangers to a much higher level. I mean, how can you argue with a guy that's been to four World Series and won three? So, I mean, if you're in Dallas and you're a baseball fan, you haven't had a lot to be excited about in the past 5 years. And now, even if it's only for a fleeting moment, you do. He's got a 3-year contract. I expect him to serve that 3 years and retire if he's not fired beforehand. So I definitely think this is kind of a clearly defined era with him, that this is what you have with him. They've got great talent on their team. They really do. I think Sam Huff is going to be great one day. You know, he's one of their top prospects, had some big league playing time. He's great. You know, obviously Jonah Heim, fantastic. They really need to shore up pitching. Now, we have seen with Bruce Bochy's managing style what he has been able to get out of pitchers. I mean, look what he got out of an aging Barry Zito multiple times. There is no one better to hire with the team issues that the Rangers have than the guy they got.
And the offense on that team needs to play better. It's simple as that. You sign Corey Seager and Marcus Semien for a combined $500 million in the offseason, and you did not get what you expected out of those two guys. I'm not saying they were horrible. Semien was
horrible.
Semien was god-awful for the first half of the year. I think he had one home run at the All-Star
break. I think he would tell you that.
That was nowhere near worth the amount of money he was signed
Both
by.
Of them are two of the most overpaid in baseball.
I mean, Seager is phenomenal. Seager, when he is on, he is top 10 hitters in baseball. Like that, he's very good. I think those two have the potential to be a really good middle infield, but they didn't really show it this year. They got to step it up next year.
Well, yeah. I think Bruce will maximize the talent with the pitching, and that'll extend the offense.
That's a good point.
Complete hire, which is he's going to address the things that Chris Woodward simply wasn't capable of addressing, and that is why this team's going to show a lot more, if nothing else, competence and confidence this next season than they have the last couple of years.
I mean, yeah, look, the Rangers made the perfect hire in my opinion. I think that 3-year contract's basically a test period. It would be a good like little earmark. Like, all right, if you make let's say ALCS or bust is basically the idea. If they can get to that mark with Bruce, then I think he'll probably continue on for a little bit. I don't think he's going to stay for like 19 years like with the Giants, but it's probably going to be at least 7 to 8 years is fair. I think
they'd be lucky to get that.
There are people who are, you know, managers who are wanting to die on that bench. I think he's Tony. One of those people that who is willing to do that.
Tony.
Yes. Tony was ready to die on that bench.
Tony was dying on that bench.
But yeah, I think that Rangers fans, though, they may need to take my words with a grain of salt, because you got to be excited, because you got to know what Bruce Bochy's coming back because he wants to.
Oh,
you know,
he's got a really good money offer, and he thinks he sees a team where he can win another rink.
I see a team where he could at least get back to competition in 2 or 3 years, yeah. If not sooner, with the big money players they've got on that roster, like Luke was mentioning. If he can maximize those guys, it's game over for the AL West. The Mariners, you know, won't be able to compete with them. I expect them to regress. You know, I mean, obviously you got the Astros are the stock of the league, sadly. Maybe they'll come down off their perch eventually. But apart from that, you know, I really could see the Rangers making a leap. So I think Bruce Bochy's a tremendous hire. Another job that came open was the Royals job. Mike Matheny was hired in 2020, fired 2 years later. That jet never really left the tarmac. There were a lot of situations with the team that
they got a lot of good young talent as well.
That's true.
Veterans. The issue is, though, who wants to go take that job because that organization is so cheap? It's A levels of cheap over there.
I mean, Patrick Mahomes is a part owner in of the Royals.
Yeah, but like they're still cheap. That's the issue. Unless they're going to show some really different signs this offseason. I expect this to still be that cheap organization that tries to be the Tampa Bay Rays, and yet they've only managed to get one ring out of that, which more than Tampa would be fair. But
speaking
still.
Of the Tampa Bay Rays, one of their main candidates that they are interested in is Matt. So stay tuned for that. And I think that they see that fit that we were discussing earlier.
Yeah.
What the Rays organization has done without a lot of resources financially and without spending big, except with the Wander Franco deal, I think that's a good fit. And I think that with Miami making the hire of Skip, it leaves the option for a team like Kansas City to look at a guy that on paper matches a lot of what they're looking for. Because the reality is they're not going to change their MO. They're not going to change the fact that they don't spend a lot of money. I don't think they think they're able to do it.
Yeah.
So that remains to be seen whether they'll hire him. I don't know. As it stands right now, they've interviewed some candidates, including their AAA manager.
That's interesting.
His name is Scott Thorman. Now, you know, the Phillies' third base coach, and they're in the World Series, the Phillies' third base coach is Dusty Wathan, and he was the Iron Pigs manager before he got called up to be the coach. So, and he's been a managerial candidate multiple times. He was a finalist when they hired Gabe Kapler in, for my money, the worst managerial hiring since I kept up with baseball. But anyways, I don't know. I think that I see a path for that. He's very popular with the players, and you've got a lot of, you know, you've got that one prospect from the Atlanta Braves, Drew Waters, on your team. Wish we still had him, but so I think that for the Royals, they're looking at candidates that are very player friendly.
Yeah.
Given where they are, they're not an old team either. So interesting discussion. Right now, with Miami being where they are, I think if there was a team that's going to hire Matt Quartaro, it's going to be the Royals. I would be willing to bet on that.
I think it might be Chicago if they're going to make that hire.
I don't believe so.
Mm. When's Jeter coming to manage the Yankees? That's what I want to know.
do we want to go ahead and talk about that?
Yeah, speaking of that, before we go to break, our last big piece of manager news, we will
I wanted to interrupt. Right now, just to describe the scene, Luke, our resident Yankees fan, and Dude, look at him. Look at him. You can't see him, but right now he is in a deep depression. He is right now wearing a Miami Marlins Jazz Grissom jersey.
I collect jerseys, man. I'm just wearing it because it looks cool. I mean,
are you sure about that?
Yes, yes. I have a lot of jerseys. I got an Acuna jersey. I wore that yesterday.
We will get into the carousel later in the show. Promise you that. But before that, we have news about some consistency in the managerial front. The New York Yankees are keeping Aaron Boone.
Yeah, consistency, all right.
Consistently
bad. Losing in the playoffs in the same round every year to the Astros every year.
He cannot manage. I'm sorry, he can't manage.
I don't think it's entirely his fault, I'm going to be honest. I'm not opposed to him coming back. I know I've ripped him a couple times on the show, but I don't think it's completely his fault. I think Cashman should take more blame for building a team that cannot perform in the playoffs and building a team that's so home run or bust. I mean, to be fair, he got a couple guys at the All-Star break that were not all home run or bust, like Andrew Benintendi, who got hurt. DJ LeMahieu, he wasn't on our roster. He's definitely not home run or bust. Bader was great in the playoffs. I mean, Cashman made some good moves at the break, but we can't just... I'm sick of buying. I really hope the Yankees are right about Volpe.
Well, yeah, who doesn't? That kid is fun to watch. Yeah. The Yankees have got some great prospects. We're going to take our first break, and when we come back, we are going to get to the talk of the town. We are going to give you a World Series preview, despite Luke being sad about it because the Yankees lost.
He's right now staring off into space. I'm not joking about this.
Phillies in four.
Phillies in six.
That means Astros in four.
No.
Well, to hear more of that, keep it tuned right here on 90.7 The Capstone.
WVUA-FM, Tuscaloosa.
Welcome back to Student Section MLB here on 90.7 FM, The Capstone, and we are coming out of our first break, as promised, with the World Series preview on deck. Friday night, Game 1 from Minute Maid Park. We got the Houston Astros taking on the Philadelphia Phillies, the surprise champions of the National League. The Astros have been the stock of the American League for the past half decade. Interesting matchup. Not one a lot of people thought they would see, but here we are. The playoffs in the first year of the expanded format was wild, to say the least. Some teams performed to expectations, some teams did not, but all roads meet here. And so I believe that we're in for a treat no matter who wins. But we here are going to break down who we think is going to show up and what we think is going to happen.
All right. So I said it a little bit earlier. Let's go, Astros. Let's go, Astros. Everyone's disappointed in me in the studio right now. I am going Astros in 4 or 5. The Phillies, you are a good playoff team, but you cannot defeat the Astros. The power of the trash can will be brought down upon you. Laugh. Come on. That was a funny joke.
Are you having fun? Like,
yes.
Tearing us apart?
Yes.
Are you forgetting your team got eliminated in the wild card round?
Welcome to my Joker arc. There you go.
How is that fair?
Come on, embrace it. Anyway, let's go Astros. I'm calling it a let's. Who should I say for MVP?
I'd go with Jeremy Pena.
I'm gonna go with Verlander. I think he's gonna have a surprise performance.
I wouldn't really call it a surprise if he played well. That man is aging like
sub
fine
2
wine.
ERA, Carson.
I know. Right.
How many games did you say?
4 or 5. One of the two.
I'm going Phillies. I've rode Phillies all the way, literally all the way, literally all the way. I shocked myself. I shocked everybody. I picked Phillies in the wild card game by the correct games. I picked Phillies against the Braves. I picked Phillies against the Padres. I mean, come on, dude. Why not? Again, Phillies in six.
Here's the issue. Here's why I also don't want the Phillies to win. Every time the Phillies win, the Philadelphia wins a World Series, we have a financial recession.
Who cares? Who cares?
No, seriously, 2008, 1980, 1928.
All right, well, if the Astros win it, I'll have a financial whatever you said.
Financial recession?
I mean... I can't have them win again.
Who can? Who wants that? Who in the world
I
wants
don't.
Carson... Your opinion.
Leave.
Your opinion is not good.
It's invalid.
It's the correct opinion.
It's not the correct opinion. They're no cheaters.
Okay, they cheated once.
Twice.
Yeah, twice. They cheated in 2019.
Arguably three times. Yeah. I don't know. They looked really good this year out of nowhere.
They cheated in 2019.
They just hit the playoffs and don't lose. They win seven straight.
That's called a good team.
The Yankees don't get swept in the playoffs. That was embarrassing. That was a disappointing, embarrassing. So many adjectives can define what I just witnessed this week. I am still talking. I'm sorry. They don't just hit the playoffs and win seven straight and sweep the New York Yankees. The 27 championship ring New York Yankees do not get swept in the playoffs. I don't care who it's to. It could be to an all-star team. They do not get swept. I'm not saying they're cheating. All I'm saying is that it was very embarrassing. It's something that just needs to change. A lot needs to change. A lot.
They need to get rid of Aaron Boone. But aside from that, I am going to stick with my prediction, and I'm also going to say...
Honestly, just like clean house.
You know, I'm sorry I'm going to interrupt. I found another MVP for the World Series. Wind.
My World Series MVP is Bryce Harper. He is going to have an insane series. He is going to hit 3 home runs in the first 3 games, and then I don't even know what I'm trying to say.
We've MVP. A different Luke. Oh my!
Bryce Harper is my
I'm
boy.
I'm so sorry, Will.
Bryce Harper is winning.
I don't have a problem
MVP.
With the things he's saying.
Bryce Harper is winning MVP, and then they're going to re-sign him. Again.
No, the Yankees will magically trade for him. There you go.
I'd be so happy with that. He'd hit 70 at New York Yankee Stadium.
Yeah.
Oh, man, I really hope somebody hits 70 again with no steroids. That'd be the greatest thing I ever saw.
I mean,
in my
if
life.
There's a guy to do it, it's the guy that's leaving the Yankees.
Yep. That can happen.
If Judge goes to the Giants, by the way, he's definitely going to be the first righty to hit one into the McCovey Cove.
Oh, yeah.
Because he does that. He just hits him oppo.
And I know Luke has said that several times on the show, and I totally think he's right. And I believe the Phillies are going to win it in 6. Bryce Harper or Reese Hoskins will win the MVP. They have been in a different mode this postseason. I mean, the fact is this.
That's a very rude hand gesture.
The Phillies are in the playoffs, for those of you that don't know, for the first time in more than a decade. And they have made the most of the opportunity up until this point. Obviously, a lot left ahead of them. But Reese Hoskins and Bryce Harper have been the offensive focal points of that, both from a vocal standpoint of them being some of the emotional players, emotional leaders of this team in the playoffs. And they have hit those baseballs a very, very, very long way. They've done it several times. And Bryce Harper hit one out to send the Phillies to the World Series in one of the great postseason baseball moments in recent memory. No cheating, no buzzers, no trash cans, no none of this. He just did it. It was totally authentic competition, unlike what Carson is rooting for. I don't understand how you can root for somebody that devalued the integrity of all professional sports.
I just want to say something quickly. As much as I do hate the Astros this year, I know they didn't cheat, and that's because the guy I hate most, Jose Altuve, started off this postseason like 0 for 150. And that doesn't happen when you know what pitch is coming, like he did when he hit the home run off Aroldis Chapman.
He did.
He knew exactly what was coming. Bzz, bzz. There's no way that a 5 foot...
Or maybe
foot,
Chapman
a
like,
had
a foot, bad pitch.
No, I'm sorry. That was a slider high and away. He doesn't pull that
they
for a home run.
They were taped on their chests.
He
there
told them
pictures.
Not to rip my jersey off.
There's literally...
I mean, a 5'7 second baseman does not take a Aroldis Chapman deep on a... Just don't even.
It was just a lucky like hit.
Yeah.
That's it.
Okay, and then no, don't take my shirt off. Don't take my shirt off. Don't. Why? No unfinished tattoo. BS. He had a buzzer right here. I'm pointing to my shoulder for everyone who can't see me right now. He had a buzzer right here that was telling him what
pitch
was
coming. He's pointing to his left shoulder. I should add.
Yeah, I am going to add that now for legal reasons there. Were no findings that the Astros cheated during the 2019 season. It was investigated. Reports from players, there were reports out there that players suspected the Astros of cheating. That was included in the investigation. No definitive findings were released that indicated that that happened. However, and this is my own opinion, this is my view, I believe that the Astros cheated in the 2019 postseason. I 100% believe it. Circumstantial evidence, to me, you reach a point with it where it's not circumstantial.
Retweet.
Thank you, Luke. And
report and flag.
No. I just –
when did you become an Astros fan is what I'm wondering. If you ever say you're a Braves fan again, because if I'm eliminated by the Phillies, I would want them to go win, especially if they're playing the Houston Astros.
And it would make me look better to lose to them if they go on to win a World Series.
Oh, yeah, we lost to the champions. I could bring that point up for me, but why, when – I would never, until the day that, even after I die, my ghost is never rooting for the Astros to win a game ever. Unless it's like, oh, the Yankees are on the verge of making the playoffs and they need the Astros to beat a team for the Yankees to make it. That is the only exception.
I love that they make Dusty Baker such an underdog because he's never won a World Series.
The man invented the high five.
The dude's like 90.
The
bro.
Dude, he's like, he took over a cheating team. And I respect Dusty Baker, by the way. I really do. I respect
I
what
do
he's
too.
Done.
I like him.
The situation he inherited was an impossible situation, especially when you consider every offseason the fact that the ownership doesn't want him to come back. And it is admirable what he has done. But the reality is they can spin whatever narrative they want on Dusty Baker, who, yeah, I like and respect, and he's one of my favorite managers in the game. But that's not going to change the fact that a lot of people outside of H-Town are not going to be rooting for the Houston Astros. And nothing, no narrative, no spin, nothing that the baseball world can do is going to change that. And I would go so far as to say that the Astros asked for that. All those years ago, they asked for it. They need to – I mean, look, you got to find some way to move on. But the reality is the baseball world just isn't going to like him, except apparently Carson, who's turned a new leaf and now supports,
where that came from,
and now supports dishonest people.
Philly, I hope to see you crash and burn. Thank you. That's all I have to say.
Is it because you just hate the Phillies? Is that the reason?
Yes.
Can you explain some of the vitriol that goes into that?
Yes.
Can you
go ahead?
Yeah.
I hate the Phillies. Okay.
Can you say your reasons?
I hate the Phillies.
Can you say your reasons and examples?
The Braves were beat by the Phillies.
Okay. This is supposed to be a more in-depth MLB radio
That's
show.
That's a very in-depth reason, if you ask me.
I beg to differ.
I mean, theoretically, anybody could say that. But I don't know. I'm at a point where I just don't want the Astros to win. I hope the Astros never win.
I wouldn't
game.
Be mad if their franchise got deleted and they brought back the Montreal Expos and
yes,
replaced them.
And they built a beautiful stadium in Montreal. Canada's such a great destination, and they have Toys R Us there. I really don't see how you could go wrong.
Yo,
with
that's
any of that.
Such a good point. I miss Toys R Us. Dude.
I really
I don't
care
how old I am.
I don't see how you could go wrong.
That place was
okay.
Dope.
Did you
put
guys,
one in
wait,
the
wait,
park?
Wait, hold on. Did you guys see the Toys R Us is technically coming back?
What do you mean?
They're putting Toys R Us stores in
Macy's
outlets.
Yeah.
So
Toys R Us.
Where's
is back?
The nearest Macy's?
There's
at the River Chase Galleria.
River Chase Galleria. Yep.
Yeah, that's by where I. That's by where I grew
Sounds
up.
Sounds wonderful.
Yes, it does indeed. Now put a Toys R Us in the Montreal park. Remove the Houston Astros. Everybody wins. Even make Dusty the manager of Montreal.
If he's alive. Sorry.
And on that note, we are going to take our second break. We will come back with more manager carousel action. Keep it here on 90.7 FM, The Captain.
WVUA-FM, Tuscaloosa.
Welcome back into Student Section MLB here on 90.7 FM, The Capstone. And we are only halfway through the show, but we are break-free the rest of the way. So stay tuned for the next about a half hour for all your top discussions about baseball here in Tuscaloosa. We're going into the manager carousel. Now, there are two jobs open. We talked about one of those jobs in depth earlier, the Kansas City Royals.
There might be three.
Say again?
There might be three.
What's the third one?
Aaron Boone.
We hope.
No. Okay, let's go ahead and sell this one right now before we talk about the other one.
He's staying, I know.
Yeah, he is staying. That's unfortunately, the Yankees organization is a little too stubborn when it comes to him. So I think that's not going to be happening anytime soon.
Well, the other job is the Chicago White Sox. Tony La Russa vacated that job due to health concerns, as we alluded to earlier. Now, we've talked about some candidates. We're going to break that down one more time. We're going to give definitive predictions on who we believe each team is going to hire. We don't know if any other openings are going to come. The Miami Marlins, we mentioned at the top of the show, hired Skip Schumacher to be the manager, the bench coach of the Cardinals, and he was one of their top candidates. We're going to start off with the White Sox job, since we already talked about the Royals job at the top of the show. We'll do it again to almost wrap things up. But the White Sox have a number of interesting candidates on the table. They're looking at Joe Espada, the Houston Astros bench coach, and he's the Eric Bieniemy of Major League Baseball. He is...
That's high praise.
He is... Well, he's the non-manager or non-head coach every year that always gets interviewed for vacancies and touted as a top name and never gets a job. But nevertheless, he's in the running for the Chicago White Sox job. Bruce Bochy, odds makers had him as the top candidate for the White Sox opening, but didn't make sense. And Bruce Bochy has been hired away by the Texas Rangers, as we talked about in the beginning segment. So Now, we do have a number of candidates. Like I mentioned, we other than Espada, we've also got former White Sox manager and world champion and one of my personal favorite personalities in baseball, Ozzie Guillen. Now, he interviewed for the Padres manager job last year. If he is hired, he will return to the White Sox for the first time since 2011, and I think it'll be very controversial because the reality is, as much as I like Ozzie, he's a funny guy, and I think he's a genius at baseball. I can't stress that enough. He's one of the most brilliant baseball minds in the game today, which is why I like him so much. He has a track record of saying some pretty controversial things, some of those things while he said while the manager of Chicago. So I think there would be some red flags to hiring him. Nevertheless, they're going to interview him. I think they may already have interviewed him. So he is a candidate. What would we think if they made that reunion happen? He's still only in his 50s, still young. So you wouldn't have – theoretically, you wouldn't have the same problems as you did with Tony. So if that – that's an unconventional route. And to be clear, I don't think they're going to do it. But if they did, how would you feel about it?
It would be an interesting choice. It makes me kind of – it feels like maybe it's another – TLA kind of bringing back someone. Maybe they'll do it this time, and then you have a couple seasons of just mediocre at best baseball. So, kind of waiting to see on that one. But I do have kind of a suggestion. I think that's kind of stewing out there that I think we'll talk about later for this job, and I think it would be a good fit.
Luke,
I mean, I'm not like really into like the whole like manager. Like, when was the last time they switched out their manager? Do you know?
The White Sox.
Yeah,
they fired Rick Renteria in 2020,
and then they brought LaRussa back.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
So, like, why did they do that? And why not?
Did they fire Rick? I thought that was too soon.
No, I mean that, and I'm saying, why did they bring in LaRussa again when
they thought they would capitalize on the young talent and win a World Series?
Yeah, well,
I mean, it's hard to argue with that. You got MVP Jose Abreu. Yeah. You got Luis Robert, who's brilliant.
Yeah.
You got Gavin Sheets, is great. Eloy Jimenez, who, while he can't stay healthy, is a great player.
Very great.
Great pitching arms. Giolito, Dylan Cease, who, again, you know, can't stay healthy. But, I mean, there were a lot of pieces for the White Sox to indicate that if they brought back Tony La Russa, who's got championships.
And they had Rodon at the time.
That's true. That's a great point. And he nearly threw a perfect game until Perez leaned into a pitch.
I mean, yeah, I see it. Did you, at the time of that hiring, did you think that was the right move, La Russa?
Honestly, I thought they should have never fired Renteria. If I am Rick Renteria, I am the most angry man in baseball.
Yeah,
jobs of a manager position, yet never really given a chance. Both teams in Chicago. For context, guys, Rick Renteria was the manager of the Cubs before Joe Maddon in 2014. They didn't have a good year, but they fired him after 1 year so
and
they could go get Joe.
And what happens the next year? Or 2 years later?
2 years. Well, they did win the World Series. It's hard to fault the Cubs for what they won.
One thing that I'm not a fan of in baseball is not giving the manager a chance. I mean, if you are cycling through managers every 2-3 years, something's wrong. Give a guy a chance to go 4 years and see what he does. If it doesn't go well, then you move on. I don't like – how are you supposed to build a team and build your – like – ideas of what the future is going to look like if you have one season to prove yourself.
Renteria did it with the White Sox. Look at the prospects he brought up to the major leagues in his time as manager, and then they axed him. I would be the most angry man in baseball if I was Rick Renteria. I wish I was seeing his name as a candidate. I really do. But with that aside, there is another candidate, and I believe this is the guy Carson was alluding to as an interesting candidate that the White Sox have reached out to regarding the managerial vacancy. That is former manager and current Atlanta Braves fan favorite and third base coach, Ron Washington.
I like Ron.
Perfect choice for the White Sox. If they went with the name, I think they would be at least contending very seriously for a World Series. I mean, look, his time in Texas, the ending was not great, but he took that Rangers team to the World Series. Did they win? No, but he kept them in contention.
Thank you, Nelson Cruz, for jumping for the ball when you could have just caught it. Ron Washington's legacy might be vastly different. Anyway, Luke, what are your thoughts?
I like Ron Washington a lot. I think he's deserved a job for a while. And honestly, I think he fits in anywhere. Like, if you told me Aaron Boone was fired and the Yankees hired Ron Washington, I would be ecstatic. I mean, I think that guy can fit into any team, any organization and just do a great job. So wherever he does end up, if he does end up somewhere, it's going to be a good hire.
I'm going to say two main things. One, Ron Washington will get another manager job. I think it'll happen in the next couple of years. Two, it will not be with Chicago. Ron Washington is 70 years old. And I just think that the White Sox are going to kind of go part of the – or not go necessarily overcorrect and maybe hire like they did with Ozzy, you know, a coach in his 30s when Ozzy first got hired. But I think that – and we'll get to this – but I think Matt Quartaro is going to be a better choice for them given the fact that Tony had a lot of health issues in his years with the White Sox.
Yeah.
And you just don't want to slow your team down like that. You just don't. And it sucks for Tony. It sucks for the White Sox. I really hate
that. Okay, I'm going to be a little mean here. Tony kind of had the issues prior to the hiring. I think that was kind of known. Ron Washington, at the moment, no one knows of any health issues that are going on. So
that's true, but I don't see them hiring him because of his age. And, you know, I don't really know. I would love Ron to stay in Atlanta. Now, granted, I think Walt Weiss is the Braves manager in waiting. I don't think that by the time Brian Snitker leaves, Ron Washington will probably be like 74, 75 years old. Maybe he won't want to manage. So I think Walt Weiss, former manager of the Rockies.
That Dusty Baker and La Russa energy.
Walt Weiss actually is he's the Braves bench coach, and he was the former manager of the Rockies for 4 seasons before stepping down. I bet he was told to do that so they wouldn't fire him. But Walt turned down the Marlins. The Marlins asked to interview Walt Weiss. This was last week. And I think it was after the show, so we didn't get a chance to talk about it. But
don't think he'll get a job before Snicker retires? Or
I think teams will call. That remains to be seen on what he will do. I think it will happen like Ron. It will happen multiple times in the coming years. I don't know what Walt will want. That could change. What Walt and what Ron wants could change even next year versus to where they are now. So who really can be sure? But I think Walt Weiss is the Braves manager in waiting. In a perfect world, I'd love it to be Ron Washington. I just don't know whether he'll retire or not. Ron was a candidate for us when Brian Snitker got hired for manager. He was a candidate for the Phillies job, which, God, could you imagine that? But now we'll move on to a candidate we have discussed at great length, and that is my personal favorite managerial candidate of this cycle, Matt Quartaro. I believe he will get hired by Kansas City. I think that is the best fit. But say the White Sox hire him. Say they do join the youth movement. I mean, they're not spending big on their rookies right now. Maybe he can make that work.
I had a question.
Yes.
Do you think after the Phillies made the World Series, do you think they stick with their interim manager?
They already signed him to a 2-year extension.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And he earned every cent of that. Yes.
Okay.
Rob Thompson is the permanent Phillies manager.
Was that recent or was that?
That was
like last week.
The week before last, actually.
Okay. I didn't even notice that. I must have missed it.
If I'm not mistaken, it was right before the Champ Series started. But, yeah, Rob Thompson is the permanent Philly manager. Great choice for Philly. I don't know how you go with anybody else. The Angels.
Does Girardi get another job?
No, not this cycle.
Yeah, no.
Not even as bench coach, third base coach?
He wouldn't take it.
Yeah, that's true. He's a very stubborn guy. I've met him.
I don't know. And honestly, I like him to go be the bench coach for the Rays if Matt left. I don't think he would do it, but it would be a nice little storyline, kind of merging eras of the Rays as good as they are now with Joe used to be the manager of the Rays. I don't know. That'd be a fun little story, but with that having been said, I don't think it happens. I think a great candidate for Rays bench coach if Matt leaves, we're circling back to all the names in my hat here, is Rick Renteria.
He needs to come back.
Yes, but
in any way,
we are now going to issue our official predictions for who goes in to each job. Actually, we're going to do two things. We're going to issue our prediction for who goes to each job, but before that, we're going to say who we want the most to go to that job because it might not be the same person. And to get us started, even though the position's already filled, we're going to talk about Miami. We're going to say who we would have wanted to go in that job. I'll start. I wanted Miami to hire Matt.
I would have wanted Bruce Bucci in Miami. I think that would have been the best choice for them.
I fully agree with you. because honestly, like, I didn't have much knowledge on Matt until, like, you pretty much, like, explained everything, and it seems like he'd be a good pick for that job, so I'm going with that.
Now, with that shelved, we got our two jobs, the Royals and the White Sox. We're going to start off with Kansas City, who we think they're going to hire and who we would like for them to hire. Now, I think they're going to hire Matt. I don't have a problem with that, but I think that a lot of the players want to see him hire Pedro Grifol, who's the current bench coach for the Royals. He is near the top of their board if he's not number one. And just for the sake of having to throw two names out there for this segment, I think he's a worthy name to mention.
I think you're completely right. I think the Royals probably would, again, in the history of Royals cheapness, I think he would be probably the best hire for them.
Oh, yeah, no,
I
mean, question.
A lot of
great.
A lot of teams have, as of recent, have stuck with inner organizational guys to bring up, and I think they do that again and stick and go with Pedro.
Okay, so you think Pedro gets the job?
Yeah.
Who would you like to get the job?
Honestly, the Royals are so irrelevant to me; it really doesn't matter. But
that division, man, that division struggles. Yeah. And before we go,
sorry for throwing shade, Royals fans.
Before we go to the White Sox, I will point out that two more managers got extended.
Right.
The Angels, Phil Nevin, got a 1-year extension, which I think
kind of shocked me.
I think there's two main reasons for that. I'd like to get into that after we talk about the White Sox. And secondly, the Blue Jays extend their manager.
That.
Don't know how that one's going to turn out. That one's 50-50 to me.
I'm fine with that as a Yankee fan. Let's just say that.
Well, we're going to go to the White Sox. We're going to say who we want to get that job and who we think is actually going to get that job. I'm going to start. I want them to hire Ozzie Guillen, but I don't think it's going to happen. I think they're going to hire Houston Astros bench coach Joe Espada. I think this is the year that Joe gets the job.
All right, I'm going to go. I think that they should hire Ron Washington, and I think they will hire Ron Washington. I think he is going to become the manager for the Chicago White Sox, as much as it breaks my heart. I think he's finally going to get that credit and deserved attention that he really needs.
I want them to take the Astros bench coach because anything that will break up that team in any way possible, I want. So just take him away from them, please. So, yes.
Well, we remember who the Astros bench coach was before Joe.
Yes, I do.
No further comment, Your Majesty.
He also cheated on the Red Sox.
Yep. As promised, we're going to get into the Angels scenarios. Now, the Angels hired Phil Nevin.
That was a little questionable, in my opinion.
The Angels have extended Phil Nevin 1 year. They hired him as the interim manager after Joe Maddon was fired midseason. Now, I think there are two main reasons that they extended Phil Nevin as manager. This is not necessarily in specific order, but these are the two reasons. One, I think that on some level in the organization, they wanted to give him a chance with that roster for a full 162 games, a full winter meetings and offseason, and a full spring training, just to see what he's really capable of. Now, if that is actually the reason, then I applaud the Angels for doing that. I know that they want to succeed fast, but it's good to give the guy a chance, like Luke was saying earlier. Now, here's another reason that I think may be in play here. I believe since they announced this move after Artie Moreno is exploring selling the Angels franchise, I think maybe they want a scapegoat other than Mike Trout or Shohei Ohtani or the other talented players that are going to come through that roster.
Do you think Shohei's going to get moved?
Yes, I do.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a particular place you think he'll go?
Dodgers.
You think Shohei Ohtani goes
to
the Dodgers?
No, they're not going to. They're going to trade him to an NL team. I think it's probably going to the Braves. I think it could be.
What? That sounds biased.
Yeah, it is biased. But at the same time, I don't think I think that
God, we can only hope.
I think Aaron Judge and Shohei Ohtani
are not
teaming
give him
up
to
in the Bay.
They're not going to give him to the crosstown rivals.
Oh, God, no. There's like 160 home runs between those two.
Yeah.
I think they're teaming up in the Bay.
You really think that?
I do think that.
What do you make of my takes on Phil Nevin's extension?
I like it. I mean, honestly, I thought it was a questionable decision to – I mean, that's why they only extended him 1 year and didn't go multiple years. You don't really see that often. I mean, he was a manager for half a year, and he did better than expected. So, I mean, why not bring him back, see what he does next year, and if he's not great next year, then so be it. Gone.
Does our Yankee royalty not know where Nevin came from?
Pitching coach.
He was your third base coach.
Oh, he was our third base coach? I thought he was our pitching coach.
I do not like the move, besides for the fact my Trash Pandas could probably get some more great players to try and go for a Southern League championship. I think this is going to bite the Angels back, and I don't think it's going to be good. They should have gone out, and they should have gone and gotten somebody for this team. They have limited years left with Trout. I think they have some limited time left with a lot of other players. This was the time to kind of go out there and take one last crack at your window. And this is another year wasted for everybody on that roster. I think they're probably going to fire him by July.
Wow, July. I do not agree with the move. I don't really think that it – and it's not to say that Phil is a bad manager. Like I have said, we don't know how he's going to perform with a full season. But – and so we don't know.
That's why they only extended him 1 year.
Yeah,
to see
it. So we don't know. But with that having been said, the Angels are in the doldrums right now, and it's the last place they want to be with their payroll being what it is. They want to win. It's no secret. They've got the two best players in baseball on their team at the same time, and they've done nothing with that. Look at the names who've passed through there. Let's do that. Let's look at the names. Look at Trout and Ohtani, who are currently there. Look at the likes of David Freese, Albert Pujols, countless more. They've done nothing with. At some point, you can't settle. And I'm not suggesting they're settling. Again, there are a lot of unknowns at play with Nevin here. But it doesn't seem like a forward-thinking move. It really doesn't. Because yeah. I did not see...
If it was a forward-thinking move, they would have signed him to more than 1 year.
Well, I did not see anything from the Angels under Phil Nevin's managing that indicated to me that they were progressing positively.
Yeah, honestly, I don't really like the move at all, actually.
Mm-hmm.
I like that it's a one-year deal.
So that Aaron Boone coaching tree.
Oh, yeah. Tell me about it.
Speaking of the Aaron Boone coaching tree, a name that I was surprised didn't gain more traction is Luis Rojas.
Yeah, he did a phenomenal job as a third base coach this year. I mean, especially after seeing that the Mets did exactly what they did with him. That's more of an organizational thing now, I guess, with the Mets. I mean, I could really see Luis Rojas getting another job. He did a wonderful job at third base with the Yankees.
And that organization, for what it's worth, they do think very highly of him.
Yeah.
And I think the fans like him. Luke likes
him. I like him. I want him to stay. I mean...
He could be the manager after Boone.
I don't know about that. That's a stretch. But I don't like him that
honestly,
much.
If Boone... you know what? That actually leads us to an interesting question that I'm just going to ad-lib right now. Luke, if Boone were to get the drop mid-season, like say the Yankees, I don't think this will happen, but say the Yankees lose Judge, lose a couple other players, come out the gates next year through the first like 40 or 50 games and suck, and they drop Boone mid-season, how do you feel about Luis in an interim role?
Matt Blake. I'd rather have Matt Blake as an intern. I love Matt Blake. I don't know what it is. I really like him. I would rather him step up from pitching coach to be the manager, the interim manager. But I don't think that would happen. I think they would probably go to Luis Rojas, who has experience in the managerial position. But I do think Matt Blake has a future in managing. I think in 6 to 7 years, you could really see him definitely being a manager on a team.
Speaking of... Rojas, and I mean, I'm already ruined the best one of these, but if one of these two teams with an opening comes at us with a complete surprise, Rojas would probably be up there, but like a name that we're not expecting would be a surprise if they were hired. Who are we thinking about? I have my name in mind. I'm interested to hear what you guys think. Who, if they got hired as a manager for the Royals or the White Sox, you would look at that and be like, wow.
Madden.
I agreed.
Yeah.
I could see that. I couldn't see it happening, but I could see myself being very surprised.
You said surprise is a hot take. Oh, he's thinking.
It's right in front of you, Luke. You're wearing a Marlins jersey.
Okay, fair. Yeah, I guess so.
Do I have to say it?
If you want.
Mattingly.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't be baffled. I would be surprised, but I think he deserves a job somewhere. Mattingly's a great mind in baseball. He deserves to be.
He has a great mind in some stuff.
As a Yankee fan, I would love Jeter to be our manager and Mattingly to be our first base coach and Curtis Granderson to be the bench coach. And
Luis Rojas stay as third base coach.
Yeah, he could stay. That's fine. And just like. like
Granderson has been thrown around at manager.
I love Curtis. Curtis Granderson was my favorite player on that team, and it's weird. It is really weird. Him and Alfonso Soriano were my two favorites. I have no idea why.
Those guys were so good at their peak.
But Curtis, growing up at my old house in New York, before I moved, I had a life-size fathead of Curtis Granderson in my room.
How
why?
Awesome is that?
Why did I have? I loved him. That lefty, center fielder, I get it. Actually, I get it now. I'm a lefty center fielder, so I mean.
I had three names in mind. Curtis Granderson was one of them.
I want him to get a job, man. I love Curtis.
Another one we've discussed is Ozzie Guillen.
Yep.
Again, I just don't see him getting a job. Mm-hmm. I believe his past comments in today's world, you have to have that conversation.
Yeah,
in today's world being what it is with the scrutiny people face for their past comments,
yep.
He's not going to get hired.
Nope, never.
And as brilliant as he is, and I'm not going to comment on my thoughts on whether he should or shouldn't, mm-hmm. because I have no interest in getting canceled on this show, but I think that is the reason he will not be hired. In today's culture of the amount of backlash people get for their past comments, I don't think he's going to be able to overlook it. Now, my other name is Diamondbacks coach Jeff Bannister.
Okay.
He was the manager for the Rangers before Chris Woodward.
Yes, he was.
And
Woodward. Oh, man, that dude's a clown. I'm sorry.
Chris Woodward?
Well, I remember he said some stuff when the Yankees walked off or something. I forgot what the comment
was.
He
also was the manager of the Rangers when Tatis hit the – when they hit the
– Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that was a fun time.
Yeah.
That was one of the best stories in baseball during just a plain old bad season.
Yep.
But
speaking of Tatis, man, is he going to get his act together next season?
Did you hear what A.J. Preller said last night during the interview?
No.
So, obviously, with the Padres infield being what it is very clustered. So, a reporter asked Padres general manager A.J. Preller, who's probably one of the most involved general managers in all of baseball, if not the most, I would put him at number one. The reporter asked A.J., what had he had conversations with Tatis, who's currently suspended for steroids, on what his role would be next year in the infield. Preller said his answer to the question was this, on the field, because Tatis really didn't play this year. So Preller said that
he really screwed them bad. Like they made it to the NLCS without Tatis, who's such an incredible player. I mean, they could be a dangerous competitor next year, especially if they're like active in the open market.
Tatis will not play for the first, 40 games.
That is true.
I think
Soto and Machado can hold down the fort for 40 games.
We're going to wrap up the show with one last manager conversation. This guy's fate has been confirmed. He will be remaining with his current team. But he has underperformed. He has gone under the line of expectations. Dave Roberts of the Los Angeles Dodgers.
Swear I thought you were going to say Aaron Boone.
Oh, we've already beat the dead horse.
That description fit him pretty damn well, I'll tell you that.
We already beat the dead horse on Aaron Boone. So we're going to move to Dave Roberts. The Dodgers already said they're going to – well, I don't know if they said this, but the reports have been that they're expected to retain him. I thought they were going to fire him.
Yeah, I thought this was it.
I mean, losing in the NLDS – to the Padres, who had 30 less wins than you guys.
And your best player suspended for steroids.
Is a fireable offense.
Here's what I think happened. Dave Roberts saved his job when the Atlanta Braves handed him the championship series 2 years ago. I still get sick thinking about it, but he would have been fired
gone, yeah.
before the game was even over
if the
Atlanta Braves had clinched that series.
Yeah.
So that leads us to this question, which we're going to take the last 2 minutes of the show and talk about. What is the end of the rope with him? If they do this again, if they lose
if
in the
they
NLDS
do it
again
this year, he's gone. I think it's World Series or bust for him.
Like winning it or
getting to the World Series. If he doesn't make it at least to the World Series this year, I think he's gone.
I mean, they got 100-win teams every year, but when you get down to the brass tacks, it really doesn't matter if you won 110 games. They won 111 games this year, and they didn't make it out of their first round of playoffs that they played.
Yeah, sounds a lot like some team that I follow.
Yeah, a very decorated team that has an underperforming manager that not a lot of people like. But anyway, we're going to close the show. We've already talked about our predictions. We gave a brief breakdown. We look forward to talking more next week as the World Series between the Astros and the Phillies is going on. But one last time for the record before we wrap up this show, we are going to give our World Series prediction.
And Player of the Weeks.
What?
Player of the Weeks, too.
Well,
if we have time.
It's going to be a lot in common with Players of the Week and MVP predictions.
Yeah.
I think the Phillies win in six. Bryce Harper is my MVP and Player of the Week.
Okay. Phillies in six. Bryce Harper is my MVP.
Astros in four or five. Everyone's staring at me. They're
pick one.
Me.
Pick four or pick five.
Five. Justin Verlander's going to be MVP. I think he's going to have an amazing performance that causes a win. And Luke is right now staring over my shoulder. Get ready to kill me after we go off the air. So goodbye, everybody.
We want to thank Carson Keel for his tremendous service, performance, and help to this show. It's really meant a lot to us, man. That is going to do it for this edition of Student Section MLB. I'm Will Miller.
Luke Torre.
And Carson Keel. I'm dead now.
We thank you again, Carson. We will see you next Wednesday on 90.7 FM, The Capstone.
WVUA-FM, Tuscaloosa.